Good evening and welcome to the Main Event Speaker Series, a program co-sponsored by the Akron Summit County Public Library and the Friends of Maine Library. This evening, Paul Bauer and Mark Dawidziak will introduce you to the subject of their just published biography, Jim Tully, American Writer, Irish Rover, Hollywood Brawler. Tully was a literary superstar of the 20s and 30s, writing about the American underclass, and has many Ohio connections. As many of you know, Mark is the television critic for the Cleveland Plain Dealer, former TV and film critic for the Beacon Journal, and creative director of the Largely Literary Theater Company. Paul Bauer is owner of Archer's Used and Rare Books in Kent, Ohio, and his personal interests include H.L. Mencken, P.G. Woodhouse, Jim Tully, travel, and baseball, especially the Negro League. Sit back and enjoy a very, very special presentation this evening by Paul J. Bauer and Mark Dawidziak.
Well, first off, thank you for the applause, but the Irish have a lovely saying, which is, wait till they do something before you applaud. So wait till we do something, and then you can applaud. If we do this right, if we do this correctly, we will answer several questions tonight, not the least of which is, who is this guy? Because I'm willing to bet that most of you in this room, when you first heard the name Jim Tully, didn't know who it was, and neither did we. And if we're also doing this right, you'll have a little sense of who he is, why he was important, why we wrote this book, and maybe most importantly of all, why it took us 19 years to write it, which is a major question to be answered. So we're going to start with a excerpt from the book. In fact, we're going to start with the very first chapter of the very first paragraph of the very first chapter. So Paul, take us out of here.
In the cool of the Western Ohio barroom, young Jim Tully sat with his father, also Jim, and his father's father, Hugh. The men drank whiskey, the boy sipped beer. As the elder Jim drank silently, young Jim looked up from his glass and studied his grandfather's face for a moment. It was a face that, by the closing years of the 19th century, had seen decades of hard work and hard drink. It was a face framed by a thick head of light gray hair and a beard beginning at his chin, with a tuft of dark hair that quickly ran to gray as it followed his jawline back. There he is. In his dark moments, he looked like an Old Testament prophet. He had few dark moments. On the contrary, no one knew better than his young grandson that old Huey could be counted on for a good story, one full of drama, humor, and not a little blarney, and never more so than when a full bottle sat in front of him, unless it was a half full bottle. The tales grew taller as the whiskey grew shorter.
You must have had a lot of fun in Ireland when you were a kid,
young Jim remarked. Huey's response surprised young Jim.
There was never any fun in Ireland, me lad. It was always a wailing and a weeping country. Hearts full of great sadness and stomachs empty of food. Fools praying to God and starving on their knees. There was never nothing like the famine of 46, and the boy here talks about a lot of fun. Hope we got your interest. So here we go. Here's where we first heard the name Jim Tully. I didn't hear it, he heard it. This starts 19 years ago. June of 1992, a fellow walks into Paul's bookstore. At this point, Paul has one of those. You remember bookstores?
Yeah.
Paul has one of those in Kent, Ohio, a brick and mortar. And a customer walks in, a friend, an acquaintance, and says to Paul,
do you have a copy of The Bruiser by Jim Tully? And let's name that particular customer since we have at least one person who remembers him. It was a local poet named Mort Crayley. And he wanted a copy of The Bruiser. And, you know, over the years of doing books, you get a lot of questions about books. And the standard response is, I don't know it. I mean, there are just too many books. I have too fragile a memory. So I didn't know the bruiser, and I had to confess, I don't know the name Jim Tully. And Mort continued, well, you know, he's considered to be the father of hard-boiled fiction, before Hemingway, before Hammett. And I was a little nonplussed, I guess, because I'm a fan of that genre, particularly Hammett and Chandler and Kane and those guys, so I was a little embarrassed that I hadn't heard of it. And then I was really embarrassed when Mort added, and I understand he lived in Kent. So here was the father of hard-boiled fiction wandering around the streets of Kent, as it turned out, for 6 years, and I had never heard of him. So I immediately pulled off the one reference book that had something on him, and the outlines of his life were really intriguing. But that was about all I could find. So I thought, let me ask someone who knows more about this than I do. And that was my friend at the Beacon, Mark.
Now, in my mind, this was the same day. Oh, this is 19 years later, so we're not all positive that this was the exact same day, but it makes a much, much better story. So that very same day, I walked into Paul's shop, and he says, have you ever heard of Jim Tully? And I said, no, should I have? And he starts to tell me the little bit that he knows, and I'm intrigued. So I'm going back to Akron that afternoon, and on my way, I stop at another bookstore, the bookseller. And sitting behind the counter at the bookseller is somebody else who's here tonight, Andrea Klein, right here. And I ask Andrea, do you have any Jim Tully on your shelf? She says, yes, we have one book, Shanty Irish. This book. She said, do you want it? It's $2.50. And I said, yeah, you're darn right I want it. So I bought this, and then I went on to the Beacon. And I went to the area of the Beacon, which John Lesky, who's worked at the Beacon, is here, knows what this term means. I went to the morgue. This is where you store dead copy that's been clipped and put into files. So I went in, and I just wanted to see whether we had a file on this Tully guy. We do. I pull it out. It says, Tully, comma, Jim, former Beacon Journal reporter. And I open the envelope and I look through the clips, and it turns out he was employed by the Beacon not once, but twice. Very short periods, he had been a failed reporter for both the Akron Beacon Journal and the Akron Press. So now I'm on the phone to Paul, and I said, Paul, you're not gonna believe this. He was here. And Paul said, where? I said, here, 44 East Exchange Street, here, the Beacon Journal. And this was just the first of many serendipitous moments that runs through this research. I mean, really, hold on to your seats, because that's about the least amazing thing that happened during these 19 years of researching this book. But the more important thing that happened was I took this book home and I read it. And Shanty Irish took the top of my head clean off. Jim Tully writes like no other writer you have ever read. Let me ask you, have you ever heard the first couple lines of a song, and within the first couple bars, you know who wrote it? Gershwin's like that. You hear the first couple lines of a Gershwin song, and you know it's Gershwin. Duke Ellington is like that. You hear the first couple lines of Duke Ellington, nobody else could have written it. It's gotta be Duke Ellington. Certain writers are like that. Certain writers, you're reading it, and you know, without any question, it's this one distinctive voice. That's Jim Tully. Yeah, he wrote like a jackhammer. It's almost like he wrote the way he boxed later on in the boxing ring. Most of you look like you have had some experience of the ring at one point or another. So most of you understand that the most important punch in the boxing ring is the jab. Everything comes off the jab. That's how Tully wrote. He's constantly hitting you with the hard realism. That's the jab. And he's constantly waiting to set you up for that tremendous right. And the tremendous right is this other side of it. And the only way I can describe it is the Irish lyricist, the Irish rover, the Irish poet. And he puts things like nobody else would have ever put them. He doesn't write like Hemingway. He doesn't write like Hammett. He only writes like Jim Tully. So now we are enthused, and we set out to find every book that Jim Tully wrote. This is before the internet. This is before you can just get on and start researching this, and we do it the old-fashioned way. And by September, we have found 14 of Jim Tully's books published between 1922 and 1942. We have a rough idea of his life, and in September of 92, we make the decision that we're going to write this book. It's a decision made on faith, because we don't know that we're going to find enough to support a full-scale biography. We have no real background of information that's going to fully flesh out a biography. But we start, and Paul, one of his places that he starts is the microfilm at Kent State University Library. We knew Tully had been a boxer during his years in Kent. So Paul is looking for the bouts he had in this area, and he's down in the microfilm. And what happens?
Well, I'm going through, have you ever gone through newspaper microfilm? You have to, your head starts swimming after a while because there's no index. I'm simply looking for his name in pages and pages of newspapers, the two in Akron, the Portage County papers, the Plain Dealer. And he was showing up occasionally in the literary pages, and on the front page writing poetry, but also in boxing. So I'm, you know, night after night going through this, and one of the librarians, I think, became curious what this sort of pointless task was that I was doing, came over and asked, and I said, I'm looking into a guy named Jim Tully, who was local. And he sort of offhandedly said, you know, let me see what I can do, because this is before the internet. And he surprised me a week or so later and came back and said, I found his personal papers, which we didn't know existed. They're at UCLA, there are 100-some boxes, and it was the gold mine. We immediately began plotting a trip to Los Angeles. When we got out there, it was like Christmas. Every box, when we opened it, we realized they had been untouched since his widow donated them in the 50s. You could see the newspaper clippings that oxidized against the better paper, leaving that familiar sort of brown shadow. Untouched. It was a treasure trove of material on not just Tully, not just correspondence, manuscripts, divorce papers, tax returns, but also Hollywood history, boxing history, literary history. It was just an unbelievable resource that no one had looked at since the 50s. So that's where we began, was assembling the outlines of his life. And there was no template, which was why every box was revelation. We didn't know what his life looked like. We really were sort of pulling this out of the boxes and creating it almost on the fly.
And we also, just to jump in on that, we almost got blasé after a while about it, after we were into like the 50th box. At first it was sort of like, oh look, a Walter Winchell letter. Oh look, a letter from Frank Capra. Oh look, a W.C. Fields letter. And by the 50th box, we were, here's another Mencken letter. This is how rich this stuff ran. But we did start to assemble. Now, to start to answer the question, why did this take us 19 years to do this? One of the things was taking all of this information. We were setting out to write something for which there was no Rosetta Stone. You set out to write a book about Hemingway or Fitzgerald. There is a scholarship built up. There is a path you can follow. we had to get our machetes out and make the path. So one of the things that I say we, but it wasn't we, it was him. He built a database of all the pieces of information we got at UCLA. Thousands upon thousands of bits of information, and he built this into a database that we could use and access as we set out to write this biography. That literally took a couple of years to do. That literally took a couple of years of our time. But out of all this information came the basic outline of Jim Tully's life, and it starts in June of 1886. He is born in St. Mary's, Ohio. St. Mary's is a canal town, and he is born into mud poverty, which would have made Frank McCourt shiver. He, despite this, the first 6 years are relatively happy years. His father is also Jim Tully, his grandfather, Old Huey, great storyteller, colorful character. He is surrounded by uncles. He is surrounded by a boisterous Irish-American immigrant family. And they are helping to drain the area around St. Mary's and helping to build the reservoir, helping to drain the farms. These are Irish ditch diggers. And this is pretty much what St. Mary's looked like a few years before our Jim was born in 1886.
Well, they were very poor, the Tullys, but it was a rural poverty. The fact that they didn't have shoes, well, no one had shoes in the neighborhood, so I don't think they were really aware of how poor they were. So the first 6 years of his life were relatively happy ones. He had brothers to play with, sisters to sort of watch the brothers. They had a mother that doted on them. The father and his father, Huey, which we saw a little bit earlier, were off doing ditch digging jobs. And it was a fairly happy 6 years. That all changed at the age of six when Jim's mother died in childbirth quite unexpectedly. It was not known, because all the children were very young, what could be done. Clearly the father, Jim Sr., was not capable of caring for them. The parish priest, I think everyone made that wise determination. He drank, he was off on ditch digging jobs, and he was present when he was present, but he was most often absent. So it was decided to send the three youngest boys, including Jim, to the Catholic orphanage in Cincinnati. Jim remembered those 6 years in Cincinnati in the orphanage, and we don't think he ever saw anything outside the walls of the orphanage as horrible. It was a prison. There were bed bugs. There were too many kids in too small an area. There were some cruel nuns, and yet Jim also remembers those years as the nuns taught him to write. They encouraged him to read. They had memory tests on Monday, which would require you to recite back on Monday the homily that you had heard the Sunday before at Mass. And these were all skills that in the long run would serve Jim well. Eventually, he simply aged out of the orphanage. He was getting too old for it. There was no social safety net, so the plan was that he was sent off to live with a farmer back home near St. Mary's, the Boroff farm. They were, as Jim recalled them, fanatical evangelicals. They had a daughter. They were particularly cruel, although Jim became very close with the young daughter. There is one particularly memorable episode where Jim had the clothes he left the orphanage with, and they were threadbare overalls. And the coming winter, the farmer would not pay for any warmer clothes or new clothes. The father, they finally found Jim's father, he came by. He would pay for clothes, but never did. So Jim went into the winter with threadbare overalls, and he remembered it in his unpublished writings as an Ohio winter that got down, I think it was 1898, it got down to like 20 below. I've spent a lot of time in this state. I was born in Akron. I don't remember any winters that cold, and I think we both sort of went with that for years, thinking, you know, he was exaggerating the way people do with childhood memories. And I don't know why it took us so long, but that is something you can verify. So we went back into the record, and Jim had, in fact, exaggerated. It was like 29 or 30 below. And he went about his farm chores with newspapers stuffed in his overalls to combat the cold. After a year and a half on the Borough farm, he could take no more. So he returned to St. Mary's and picked up odd jobs. He worked, there was a chain factory in St. Mary's. He became a heater boy, heating links, sort of a junior apprentice for the chain factory. But more importantly, he began hanging around the railroad yards, hanging around the bars. There were brothels in St. Mary's, and that's really where he got his education. As the railroad men and hobos and others came to drink, he became fascinated with their stories about this outside world. So far, he had seen little outside of Auglaize County and the walls of that orphanage. And as these stories were fed to him, he just became completely fascinated by it, that there was this world out there that was open to him, and he had to escape St. Mary's. And after a few tentative attempts at hopping a train, one in which he fell off the train and had his foot not crushed, he lost a shoe and only bruised his foot, but I think he saw early on how dangerous it was. But he became more and more courageous about it and finally fled St. Mary's for good. Now, the world in which he entered as a hobo, and he was really a road kid or a junior hobo, was fraught with peril. In fact, if you read the papers a couple weeks ago, a college girl was hopping trains just 2 weeks ago with some friends, fell under the wheel, lost her legs. So this was a constant terror. There were people died. Most railroad right-of-ways, in fact, have unmarked graves. The railroad men, as they would find dead hobos and road people, would simply bury them. Additionally, beside the horrors of traveling by train and jumping the train, there was a public health campaign to eliminate hobos and this scourge of humanity on these steel rails. And the language that they borrowed for this was the language they had just used in their campaigns to eradicate vermin, except now they were looking at what they regarded as human vermin. So there were public health campaigns. Do you want to talk about this particular photo?
This is a 1905 photo. So this was taken. This is from the Library of Congress. It was part of a project to document hobos and life on the road. There are no interstates. Hoboing at this point means hopping onto freight cars. The gentleman at the top is what is in the vernacular known as a railroad bull. That is a detective hired by the railroads to keep hobos off their trains. The man in between is a hobo. And this picture very graphically demonstrates how danger and death lurked around every corner of the road that Jim Tully got on. Now remember, he's only 14 years old when he sets out on the road. He's on the road for 6 years. And as he would always say, he was not a hobo, he was a road kid. Road kids were tougher. You never got into a scrap with a road kid. And death could hit you in so many different forms. You know the expression, riding the rods? Now, we have come to use that phrase to mean getting on a train and riding the train for free. That's not what it means, and it's not what it meant in the time of the hobo. The rods is this structure underneath the train. Riding the rods meant holding on to those underneath the freight cars. Sometimes taking your belt and looping it around the rods and holding on for dear life to get a ride. The railroads were so vicious in trying to keep the hobos off them that some railroads would take wire with lead weights attached and throw them over the front of the train so they would trail underneath, knocking off any hobo that was riding underneath, riding the rods, certainly killing them. So this was the type of world that Jim Tully was in. He would get off the road occasionally during these 6 years to work for a small circus in the South, and ladies and gentlemen, this is not the greatest show on earth. This is about as low as life gets. He sometimes is staying in Chicago at the Newsboys' home. He is sometimes working in chain factories, learning how to make chain during this time. But he is traveling the roads of America, and he is learning America's hidden people. He is learning their underclass, people who do not have a voice, people who do not have any way of saying, here I am, notice me. Jim Tully is noticing them, not only because he is among them, but because he is of them. Now, one of the very, very, very few places you could be safe and warm if you were a hobo in those times was the public library. And public libraries figure very, very greatly in Jim Tully's story. It is here that he is going to get his true education. He also called himself a library bum because he was staying in these libraries and he is reading. He got the reading habit from his father. He also was encouraged to read in the orphanage. And now that he's out on the road, he is starting to read the writers who are going to most influence him. He's reading the Russian writers. He's reading Jack London. He is reading Mark Twain. He is educating himself. And there are two key decisions in Jim Tully's life. Both took enormous courage. The first decision was to break away from St. Mary's and get out on the road and actually make that break. The second great decision was curing himself of the road and getting off of it. He is warned over and over again to get off the road. He's only 20 years old at this point. And when he decides to get off the road, it's going to be in a town that looks a whole lot like St. Mary's. You all know where this is, don't you? This is looking out the back of the Puffer Belly restaurant just about 100 years ago. And when he gets off the road, this is where he does it. Right here. He hops off a freight car. Right around here, he describes it in one book. He describes the train tracks running along the Cuyahoga River, leading up to the Great Bridge. This was actually taken a little bit before he got off that freight train. The baggage chute had been removed by that time, but everything else is there. He gets off that train. And when he does, here's another serendipitous moment, which we did not know about. When he drops off this train in 1907, he is doing it literally about three blocks away from where Paul and I are going to have our first conversation about Jim Tully in 1992. Paul's shop was just up the street from here. So another one of those wonderfully serendipitous moments. Anyway, he gets up the bridge, and he sees something to his left when he goes over the bridge that's going to warm his heart. He sees what's still standing there, a Carnegie library. And with libraries come what? Librarians. He goes and he works in the chain factory, and in his spare moments, he is in the library and he meets the first librarian in charge of the Carnegie Free Library in Kent, Nellie Dingley. They are outsiders. They are both outsiders in this town. Nellie comes from money. Nellie comes from a fine family in Ashtabula. And she encourages him to write. She starts to give him things she thinks he should read and starts to tell him he could be the next Jack London. Interestingly enough, a destiny that's already been named for him by his older sister, Virginia. His older sister, Virginia, had gotten it into her head that he should become a writer. Why? Two Irish kids from this kind of poverty, she might as well have said he should go to Mars. But Nellie sees something in him too, this rough kid working in the chain factory. and a romance does ensue. Now, during the years he's in Kent for about 4 years. This is the period where he's going to try to be a reporter at the Beacon and fail, try the Akron Press and fail. He's also launching a boxing career. He is boxing as a featherweight. He's a little guy. He's about 5'3", very much on the slight side, and he's working his way up the featherweight ranks. It's Nellie who gives him the key question of his life. It's Nellie who says to him, "What is the good of whipping the whole world and ending up a bartender?" She's the one who makes him decide he needs to become a writer. And when the chain factory in Kent burns down, they almost all burn down eventually with all those forges. Theaters and chain factories almost all burn down in those times. He decides he needs a different kind of occupation. So where does he go to work?
Well, there was a young company by a father and son in Kent, John and Martin L. Davy, and the company still exists. It's still based in Kent, and Jim became friends with Martin L. Davy, who encouraged him to take their course and become a tree trimmer. So Jim, he called himself not a tree surgeon, but a tree faker, F-A-K-I-R. So he became a tree surgeon, and they were sent to various jobs in surrounding states. And what's significant about this, I mean, certainly Jim was a guy who could travel, but they had a company even then, a company newsletter, and Jim would send back dispatches from the field about a tree trimming job in Pennsylvania or Illinois or somewhere in Indiana. And they were so fanciful that Martin L. Davy really encouraged him to continue writing. I mean, one of the tree trimming jobs he was talking about, he was comparing it to Napoleon and Wellington, and I mean, it's just, it's really incredible, but it's the sign of someone who's well-read and wants to write and is just trying to spread his wings. And it really was the Davy Tree Company that gave him his earliest chance to do that. So he was working as a tree trimmer. He left that job, became an independent tree trimmer. He and a friend drifted down to Marion, Ohio, trimmed the trees of its most famous resident, Warren G. Harding. And there's a wonderful scene. At the end of the day, they're sitting on Harding's porch drinking, I would have to guess it's bourbon, watching fireflies in the Ohio night. One guy, not knowing that the person he's drinking with is going to become president of the United States, the other guy not realizing the person he's drinking with is going to become this, you know, nationally famous writer. Well, to return to his failed romance with Nellie, she rejected him, but did continue to encourage him to write. On the rebound, he married a high school girl from Kent. This is her somewhat after high school, and they married. Her name was Florence Bushnell. While he was still in Kent, they had a son, Thomas Alton. They called him Alton. And he's still trying to write part-time. He's getting poetry published in the local papers. In fact, his first poem was published in Mark's paper in The Plain Dealer, and it was a poem about John Keats. You know, as we've done these, I've sort of made disparaging comments about his poetry, that it was sort of poetry of the time, kind of maudlin or a little sentimental, it was rhymed. And you know, my wife was saying the other day, I just read the Keats poem, I kind of liked it, so maybe we've been too hard on him. Maybe his poetry was better than we thought. At any rate, the subjects of his poetry really were what was interesting to me. He wrote a poem about Samuel Gompers. I submit, who writes poetry about the father of American labor except someone who's well-read and actually, Jim's case was sort of brown-nosing. I think he sent it to Gompers hoping it would get him a job, which didn't happen. So he's writing poetry in the local papers. They're being picked up. And he's really now seriously becoming interested in writing. But he also has a family to support. They decide, the young family, the three of them, that they are going to drift across the country. Jim will pick up tree-trimming jobs as they make their way west. Florence and Alden are sent ahead along with her family to Los Angeles. The family settles in Hollywood. Jim pauses along the way. in the Chicago area and gets involved in a murder by poisoning trial, of all things. I mean, these are just the sorts of things that gravitated toward him and he toward them. He does eventually land in Hollywood. He makes a serious decision that he is not getting anywhere with his writing, supporting a family. So his decision, improbably, is that he's going to write or starve. The corollary to that decision is that he has a wife and child who might starve with him. But he decides that he will not do part-time work anymore. He is going to somehow make it as a writer. And he, in fact, has his first book, an autobiographical novel called Emmett Waller, published as he is in Hollywood.
And I'll back that up just for a second. Another one of those serendipitous moments. His very first professional appearance in print is that poem on Keats' grave. It is not only published at the newspaper where I'm working now, The Plain Dealer, it was published 100 years ago this year. So this is the 100th anniversary of Jim Tully's first of professional appearance in print. Okay, Emmett Waller is published in 1922. It gets good reviews. He makes the mistake of taking the advice of an established writer who told him not to write it in the first person, that no good book has ever been written in the first person. I guess Huckleberry Finn was not a good book. And he took that advice, and he turned it all around and wrote in the third person. Even so, the book got decent reviews. However, he had neglected to ask for an advance. He was so unschooled in the way of books, he had forgotten to ask for one, and the publisher had neglected to offer one. So as he put it, he was poverty-stricken with success. So he needs to still support a family. And at this point, somebody enters the picture who always seems to come along at a time in Tully's life. There always seems to be somebody who's there for him. And in this case, the person who's there for him is named Paul Byrne. Now, Paul Byrne is pretty much forgotten today. But Paul Byrne is going to go on to become Irving Thalberg's chief lieutenant and running MGM. He's going to marry Jean Harlow. And he's one of Jim Tully's best friends. And he invites Jim to a party where Jim is introduced to the reigning star of the silent screen, the little tramp, Charlie Chaplin. And Chaplin offers Jim a job at his studio. Now, Chaplin studios still exist. They are now the home of the Muppets. Jim Henson Productions are now in Chaplin studios on La Brea. But in those days, this was where Chaplin made all his movies. And he brings Jim on board to be a sort of a catch-all writer. Jim is writing publicity. He is ghostwriting stories that go out under Chaplin's name. He is contributing plot ideas, sitting in on story conferences. It's a pretty easy job. He's with Chaplin for a year and a half. And during this year and a half, Chaplin's working on a film that many still consider his masterpiece, The Gold Rush. So he's observing Chaplin at an incredibly fertile period. They never get close. I love this picture, by the way. I love this picture because this is basically the little tramp with the genuine article, is what this is. They never get close, even though there's a lot of similarities. They both came from poverty. They both had tragedy. Chaplin's mother was committed to an insane asylum when he was quite young. Tully's mother died when he was six. There is an awful lot of parallels, and yet they're very wary of each other. It's almost like they're always observing each other as mirror images. But during this period, he is working on his second book, and this book is not going to be a commercial failure. This one is going to be a runaway success. This is the book which indeed is going to define him as a writer. This book is this book. It is Beggars of Life. This is his first-person account of the 6 years he spent on the road as a road kid. And this book turns the literary world on its ear. Within 2 years of this book being published, there is a Broadway adaptation of this book. It is adapted by no less than Maxwell Anderson, one of the leading playwrights of the 1920s. He turns it into a play that he calls Outside Looking In. And an actor who's going to go on to be quite well known in Hollywood. Charles Bickford plays the Oklahoma Red, the tough hobo, veteran hobo. But they need an actor to play young Jim in this. And so he's got to be on the short side, he's got to have red hair, and he's got to be just bursting with energy. And they really can't find a legitimate actor to do that. So they hire a song and dance man to do it, a guy who just basically has been known for being a song and dance. I see a lot of heads going up and down, because you already know it's Jimmy Cagney. And so Jimmy Cagney gets his big break playing Jim Tully. And this is a great success. Within a couple of years of the Broadway play, there's a film version of Beggars of Life, directed by no less than William Wild Bill Wellman, who's going to go on to direct The Oxbow Incident. He's already directed the first film to win the Academy Award, which is what?
Wings!
There, give that man a cigar. Wings. So, Beggars of Life becomes a Broadway play and a movie, and Tully is on his way. He now starts a second career. While he is writing these books, he starts writing books chronicling what he saw during those 6 years when he was on the road. He starts to become the chronicler of the American underclass. Before Steinbeck, he is giving a voice to the people who do not have a voice. He is saying, you must pay attention to these people. Beggars of Life is just the first of these incredible books. But he now starts a second career as the first journalist covering Hollywood honestly. Up to this point, coverage of Hollywood has been restricted to handouts given to newspapers by the studios, and the newspapers gladly reprint these press releases, and nothing is ever wrong in Hollywood. Everything is always wonderful. Jim Tully knew a little better than that, having observed Hollywood pretty closely at this point. And he is not friendless in Hollywood. He has many, many close friends that he used to hang around with. A bunch of them used to hang around on Hollywood Boulevard, one by one, waiting to see who was going to break through. Among them is the director Eric von Stroheim. Among them is an actor by the name of Lon Chaney. Another actor is driving a truck. He's going to have to wait a lot longer. His name's Boris Karloff. But this is the amazing group of people he's hanging around with at this point. And he starts to write articles for the big magazines back east, like Scribner's and Vanity Fair. And he is writing these big profiles of these actors. By our standards today, these pieces do not look all that tough. By those standards, they thought this guy was roughing them up. And only one piece really stands out as being particularly harsh. He wrote a profile of an actor by the name of John Gilbert. Now again, Gilbert is largely forgotten today. But around 1928, John Gilbert was being positioned to be the heir to Rudolph Valentino as the next matinee idol sex symbol of the silver screen. It didn't quite work out that way for John Gilbert, who had the knack of making enemies, not the least of which was the man who was paying his paycheck. Tully wrote a profile of John Gilbert, basically using Lon Chaney as his source. Chaney hated John Gilbert, thought John Gilbert was the worst kind of ham, had worked up just an incredible animosity towards Gilbert, and he poured all of this into Tully's ear, and Tully poured it all into print. This piece is so harsh that when Gilbert read it, he threw up. And he festered about it for 2 years. And we're going to come back to that in a second. Meanwhile, Tully is continuing to write these amazing books about the American underclass. He is indeed becoming what H.L. Mencken called him, our Gorky. Circus Parade is about those small, grimy little circuses in the South that he worked for. This is in many ways his grittiest, most disturbing book. What goes on in these circuses is pretty horrifying. This was followed by Shandy Irish, which is his most affectionate book. This is about his mother's family, the Lawlers, and his father's people, the Tullys. This sometimes come off as a bit of the quiet man. There are grand stories told in this book. One of my favorites is Jim's Aunt Ma, his mother's sister, did the unthinkable thing of trying to join the Methodist Church. And of course, her father and her brother had to go rescue her from the Methodists. So they set off in a buckboard down to the Methodist Church, and they found the pride of their family surrounded by Methodists, and in they went. And this great battle is described in the book, and the last line of the chapter is, they're driving back home, and Jim's grandfather, Lawler, says to his son, "Ah, Dennis, me boy, how proud I was of you tonight. Every time your fist fell, there fell a Methodist." So, this is a very affectionate book. Old Huey is the star of this book. And just give you a second and give you an idea of Tully's writing. This is the first paragraph of Shandy Irish. This is how he describes Old Huey. My grandfather was known as Old Huey Tully. Born with the gift of words, he was never without a tale to tell. Drama was as natural to him as corn to an Ohio farmer. Arson, treason, and sudden death were as common in his Irish boyhood as gossip about the King of England. He respected nothing among men. He was capable of turning death into an Irish wake and pouring liquor down the throat of the corpse. That's his description of Old Huey, and it carries right on through the book. Shandy Irish is followed by Shadows of Men, which runs neck and neck with Circus Parade as his grittiest book. This is about the grifters, the con artists, the convicts he met during the 6 years he was on the road. And then finally, the fifth book of what he called his underworld cycle. These five books were the books he thought were going to be what his literary reputation would be based on. Blood on the Moon, Old Huey Comes Back, this starts in the orphanage in Cincinnati, and it's basically about his journey to making himself a writer. Kent figures very prominently in this book. His boxing years figure very prominently in this book. So those five books, Beggars of Life, Circus Parade, Shandy Irish, Shadows of Men, and Blood on the Moon, are the cornerstone of Tully's literary accomplishment. And all during this time, again, he is also writing these Hollywood profiles, writing for the fan magazines, and this is the more lucrative part of his career. Now this, who is this? Very good. Louise Brooks it is. Louise Brooks is now a cult figure. And she's kind of a different kind of movie star for the 1920s. Why is that, Paul?
Well, she's very androgynous. Hollywood, I think, then and now certainly was comfortable casting women as the girl next door or a vamp. But with her androgynous appearance, they didn't quite know what to do with Louise Brooks. I think, certainly, she paved the way in many ways for Katharine Hepburn. But she was perfect for the role of in the Beggars of Life movie because of her androgyny. In the movie, which is based, I think, more on the Anderson play than the book, she is fleeing an abusive stepfather, and she disappears into the role of the hobo. But to survive, she has to pass as a boy. So she was really perfect for this role. This is largely a silent movie. We have a clip from it. You'll hear a score, which is a much later score. This is not the original score. So let's play a clip from the film, Beggars of Life.
That's Richard Arlen with her, who plays the Jim character. Wallace Beery is also in this film, playing Oklahoma Red. I love this scene. It has so much yearning for the open road in it. watch this. You're gonna learn the proper way and improper way to board a train, because there's more than just entertainment going on here, there's education. Wrong way.
I'll add that Louise felt quite abused on the set. She hated everyone. There was no stunt double, and she felt like she had to reshoot that scene really way too many times. So she was not happy. She eventually continued her career in Germany. She was so disillusioned with Hollywood. The really great thing about this country is there's always another train.
You look in the upper right-hand corner, here it comes. Okay, start taking notes. This is the right way to do it. You get out in front of the train, and you start running, so the train's not going too fast, and you're keeping up your speed. You never try to do it from a standing position, it'll rip your arm out. When your speed and the speed of the train are roughly the same, up you go. And there you are.
That is Beggars of Life, which is seldom seen. I that does not show up on Turner. This movie, Wait for a Sailor, does show up on Turner. In fact, it just aired a few months ago. Do you want to talk about John Gilbert?
This is 1930. Now, what you see here is a still from Wait for a Sailor. What the fellow in the middle is John Gilbert. And next to him is our friend Jim Tully. And over here is Wallace Beery. Now, how does Jim Tully end up in a film? Here we go. Remember I said that he wrote an article that was so harsh about John Gilbert that John Gilbert threw up? Well, John Gilbert festered about that for 2 years. And all during these 2 years, his career went farther and farther off the tracks. So, 1930, John Gilbert walks into a landmark Hollywood restaurant, the Brown Derby. And who is sitting in the Brown Derby with his back to him, a shock of red hair, stocky figure, sitting in a booth? But Jim Tully, the man who had written the article that he associates with his career starting to go off the tracks. Something snaps in John Gilbert, and he goes for Jim Tully. At this point, we're not sure whether it was Gilbert or somebody else who called out, "You'd better get on your feet." But Tully hears those fateful words, and he jumps up, and he immediately forms the letter S. Now, for those of you who don't know, get that reference, that's a boxing term. He's in a boxer's crouch. Gilbert comes at him, throws two wild punches, misses with both, and Tully sails a right over the missed punches and knocks him out cold with one punch. The police are called, and the police ask what they always ask in situations like this: all right, what happened? And Tully's answer is, well, I'm not sure. This man came running at me, wildly swinging his arms. He was creating such a breeze, I was afraid he was going to give himself a cold, so I put him to sleep for his own protection. This makes headlines all across the country. Newspapers pulled their political cartoonists out of the politics for a little while to draw the fight. There's Tully throwing the right. There's Gilbert going back. Little X's in his eyes to indicate he's out. Headlines over. One round knockout. Tully KO's matinee idol. It is a humiliating moment for John Gilbert, who doesn't really need another humiliating moment. But one of the enemies he's made is Louis B. Mayer, his boss. Louis B. Mayer is one of the M's at MGM. And Louis B. Mayer understands good publicity. So he rushes Jim Tully into John Gilbert's next film. They play Three Sailors on Leave. To further humiliate Gilbert, he puts Wallace Beery in the film, who is one of Jim Tully's closest Hollywood friends. Now, they patched it up on the set. This was actually a fairly happy set. It does not mean it turned out to be a good movie. This is a transitional sound movie, and the sound is not very good. The dialogue is not very good. It was directed by Sam Wood, who would later go on to direct A Night at the Opera with the Marx Brothers and Goodbye, Mr. Chips. But this film is interesting to us and valuable to us because it contains the only known film footage of Jim Tully. It's the only way we know what he looked like and what he sounded like. And once again, the sound is not very good, but we have two scenes we want to show you. The first is?
Well, the first is Jim and John Gilbert, and these are sailors on shore leave talking about what sailors usually talk about when they hit the shore. Their dialogue is really unimportant, so if you can't pick up what they say, it's really what happens at the very end of this scene, unspoken, that is, I think, the best moment, certainly the only genuine moment in this film. So here's one clip from the first clip from Way for a Sailor.
A few minutes to give you the air this time. That kind takes years of hard work, buddy. Ain't 1,000 worth it. This might be the one. What'd you do with the bracelet?
I left it.
You what?
A little bait don't do any harm. When that little canary opens her cage and peeks out, she'll be right there blinking at her. First she'll look at it, and then she'll try it on, and then little Jack will come along.
You must be nuts.
Ah, you ain't experienced. The thing to do with women is find out their weak point. First thing you know, their weak point will be old age. Ain't any of them got anything on me.
No.
The significance of the scene is that the kid looks exactly like Jim Tully.
And recreating a scene that the young Jim Tully had lived through countless times. This second clip, remember, this is sort of a Three Amigos, a Three Buddies movie. At this point, later in the movie, the Wallace Beery character, they believe, has drowned. So you have Jim and John Gilbert remembering their friend. I think this is an exercise in trying to get every cliche possible about a deceased friend into 45 seconds of film. But you also pay attention, they're playing with a concertina, a little squeeze box. And this is something earlier in the movie that the Beery character never let go of. He was always playing with this little squeeze box. And that's the probably the thing to watch for in this clip.
And Beery's character, by the way, is provocatively, his name is Tripod. How they ever got it by the censor, I don't know.
No. I still can't imagine him being dead.
It's a big, strong bug, too. I think he'd beat the whole ocean to pieces before he gave in.
With them arms, he could do anything.
Remember the time he cleaned Big Minnie's joint out all by himself? Ah, he had a heart, too, that lad. Figuring all outdoors. It ain't right, Jack, that's right. The best always goes first. Say, maybe we should have left this out there. I don't know, something to remember him by. I know, but with that poor guy floating around out there, I keep thinking I'd like to see him rolling around in the waves and just bumping right into it. They kind of belong to each other. I guess it would be more proper. Yeah. Here you are, tripod, old pal! The night of all the mermaids and the dancing in the sea!
Hey, you big chucklehead! What's the idea?
Tripod!
Well, I'll be... Say, tell me what you done it for.
I was just throwing it back to you, old pal. We thought you were dead.
Yeah, well, the next time, don't you think. Go and get it.
I didn't throw it!
Now, when they shot that off the California coast, to Jim's good fortune, Wallace Berry asked him, "You can swim, right?" And incredibly, for a kid who grew up, you know, in the country, Jim couldn't swim. So Wallace explained to him, you know, this is why they have stuntmen. So the actual person going over the side was not Jim. They cut it and had someone else go over the side who could swim. So that is probably all we need to say about Wait for a Sailor. And that was the one and only time that Jim appeared in front of the camera.
Now Jim has, because of his, the articles that he's writing, and because he never lost this tremendous right he had in the ring, he had two nicknames, the most hated man in Hollywood and the most feared man in Hollywood. But he was far from friendless in Hollywood. In fact, one of his closest friends was his near neighbor in Toluca Lake, W.C. Fields. This was a very, unlike Chaplin, he never got close to Chaplin, he got very close to Fields. But he had a lot of very good friends in Hollywood, Jimmy Cagney, Frank Capra, Clark Gable. These were all people who he counted on as friends. And he also had many good friends in the literary world. Damon Runyon was a very good friend. George G. Nathan, H.L. Mencken, was probably his closest friend and certainly his literary mentor. So he was far from friendless during this period. I love this picture. This is my favorite picture of Tully. It was taken on the MGM lot, and you can almost just about picture him sneering at the Hollywood parade as it went by. Somebody once asked him why he lived in Hollywood. And his response was, "Because as a kid, I got used to circuses." This is his writer's desk, writer's room. Tully surrounded his desk with little framed pictures of writers who were his personal heroes, his role models. In the upper corner, way up there, that's Mark Twain. Directly over Tully's head is Joseph Conrad. So these are two of his literary idols. And
he has something that, in the days before computers, I think was every writer's best friend. He had the biggest wastebasket I've ever seen. Now, we had sort of left his marriage off. He and Florence did divorce, the mother of his two children. He married a co-ed named Marna, and that marriage was very... very passionate, but very turbulent. And there, at various points, the marriage was coming unglued, and it was appearing in the papers, and there were allegations of affairs. And like a couple that decides that they're going to have a baby to save the marriage, these two decided that the way to save the marriage would be to travel abroad and to write a book about it. And that is his one and only travel book. It is Beggars Abroad. The I don't think it made it on the screen. It's below the screen. But there's a PA would be right about there, and that's Peter Arno, the New Yorker cartoonist who did the artwork for it. It's, you would not know reading Beggars Abroad that this was a couple on the rocks. It's actually very affectionate the way he writes about his wife. It is interesting. Jim considered this book a failure. It's his only travel book, and I rather like it. He doesn't so much go to the usual tourist spots. He goes to things that are interesting to him. The founder of boxing, he goes to his grave. More importantly, he goes to visit some of the literary luminaries of the time. H.G. Wells, he has a visit with Wells and writes about it. He visits George Bernard Shaw. And, this great man of letters. And Tully wants to talk to Shaw about politics, about socialism, about literature. And he's frustrated because Shaw continually returns their discussion to boxing. All Shaw is talking about is boxing, and Jim wants to talk about sort of high concept things. Shaw's not having any of it. He travels to Paris and has a memorable encounter at his apartment with James Joyce, who has a manuscript on his desk that is at that time called simply Work in Progress, and that manuscript will become Finnegan's Wake. So he's met these two Irish titans of literature on this trip and written about them. And this is, I think, a really terrific book and one that I would love to see reprinted at some point. So that is Beggars Abroad. His career by the late 30s is flagging. Beggars Abroad was not a success. There were personal problems, mainly related to his son, who was constantly in trouble and in fact ended up in San Quentin. Tastes are changing as we're getting into the war. And Jim was constantly trying to mount a comeback, to reestablish himself. This book, The Bruiser, is a straight novel. It is not autobiographical, although clearly it was written by someone who had extensive knowledge and experience inside the ropes. It is, I think, the best novel about boxing. Unfortunately, as it came out of the gate in hardcover, it was considered something of a failure. It did not reestablish him, although as pocketbooks became popular during the war for servicemen to carry around, The Bruiser, the pocketbook, became a very big success. So it did ultimately make him money, but it did not initially reestablish him. The one that really should have put him back on the map, and it was his last serious attempt at a comeback, was this book, Biddy Brogan's Boy. His editor was Maxwell Perkins, who had a pretty good track record editing Thomas Wolfe, F. Scott Fitzgerald, and Ernest Hemingway. This is an autobiographical novel. This focuses, again, on his childhood. It's really quite different than Shiny Irish. It's a marvelous book. This should have put him back on the literary map. Unfortunately, the problem came with one of Perkins's and Scribner's other clients, Marjorie Rawlings, who had just won a Pulitzer for her book, The Yearling, and was coming back with her follow-up book, Cross Creek. And the buzz was all about Cross Creek. She was the hot young writer, and when that book came out, everybody wanted to read about Marjorie Rawlings' book, which deservedly so, was terrific. Nobody paid any attention to this old salt named Jim Tully, and Biddy Brogan's Boy really was a major disappointment, and the last time he mounted a serious comeback.
And in 1942, while he's writing Biddy Brogan's Boy, he suffers a massive heart attack, and this is the beginning of a five-year decline. For the last 5 years, they are not good. He is not only suffering from heart ailments, he is suffering from severe and crippling arthritis and rheumatism and circulatory problems, and he really can't write. So this is 5 years of gradual decline. This is his daughter, Trilby. You can see he has been reduced. This is getting towards the end. He is walking with a cane at this point. His red hair is turning white. He dies in June of 1947. He is only 61 years old, but he looks a good 15 years older. This is the hard early life catching up to him. He is finally, that great body is starting to break down. And when he dies, he still merits a fairly big obituary in the New York Times. He is still pretty much a household name. But now we get to one of those key questions that we started with. Why was he forgotten? Why was Jim Tully go from a household name? Well, in truth, most of the writers of the 20s and 30s went into eclipse during World War II. The whole publishing industry went into a state of suspended animation during World War II. Paper was being conserved. Most of the publishing was going towards books for the soldiers. After World War II, the old guard was pretty much blasted away temporarily by a new breed of young writers who were drawing on their war experiences, writers like Norman Mailer and James Jones. Now, if you had been a big writer in the 20s and 30s, there's only two ways back, folks. You either write your way back the way Hemingway and Faulkner did, both of them winning Nobel Prizes in the 1950s, or you had a literary champion who carried your cause into a new decade the way Fitzgerald did. In Tully's case, his literary champion is H.L. Mencken, the Sage of Baltimore. A year after Jim Tully dies, H.L. Mencken suffers a massive stroke and cannot read or write for the last 8 years of his life. So going into the 50s, Tully's still pretty well known. By the end of the 50s, he's going, 60s, gone. And none of the books are in print at that point. And that pretty much takes us to 1992. And I walk into a shop and somebody says, do you know the name Jim Tully? Go back one, Paul, just real fast. This, of course, is Jim Tully's grave. He is buried in the Glendale Forest Lawn. It's wrong. The year, it should be 1886, it says 1891, but that is his signature. It is a based on his actual signature. But the great serendipitous thing about this is that where he's buried, it's a slope in Forest Lawn called the Whispering Pine Slope, and two rows down, John Gilbert. Gilbert couldn't even get away from him in death. And this is when we first went to St. Mary's and started doing our research, we went to Glenwood. Now, Glenwood is a little area, it's a whistle-stop community right outside St. Mary's. It was an Irish-American community. There's a church there, St. Patrick's, and a little churchyard attached to the church. This is where Biddy is buried. But when we went there, it was an unmarked grave.
We were poking around,
and the priest saw us and came out of the rectory and came across the street and said, you know, can I help you? And we said, well, you know, we were looking for this grave for Bridget Biddy Lawler Tully, and he got out his chart, and he said, it's right here, but it's an unmarked, it's probably just a wooden marker, and it has long since disintegrated. So the families, the Lawler and Tully, paid for this to be put in 2007, and it says, mother of novelist Jim Tully, great heart of my mother under the weeds of Ohio. With love from the descendants of Jim Tully and the Lawler family, 2007. And this is where we end our formal part of the presentation and take your questions. We end with a reading from Shanny Irish because it relates to Glenwood, the cemetery. And this takes place at a point in Shanny Irish where Jim is 14 years old. He has left the Boroff farm. He has not yet left for the road. And he is working in a combination saloon and restaurant. He is a dishwasher. And he's washing dishes in the window of the restaurant. The sink is up in the window, so everybody who goes past can see him washing dishes, and his friends can tease him, the people in town can make fun of him and jeer at him. This is about the lowest of the low points before he leaves for the road. His grandfather, old Huey, does not have long to live. He's gonna die a few months later. But this is the scene that Jim depicts in Shanny Irish. My loneliness was intense. I was working in a combination saloon and restaurant. I stood in back of the lunch counter, sleeves rolled to my elbows, a greasy apron tied about me. The dish sink was so near the street that people could see me as they passed. The teasing made my life weigh more heavily upon me. When my grandfather came, I threw my childish pride away and broke down in his arms. He caressed me roughly and said, come for a walk with me. As if to ease my heart, he talked constantly. You shouldn't be washing dishes. You're too wild a bird for so greasy a cage. We're both savages, me boy. Your old granddad knows things. He can lie in bed at night and hear the world go round. That's made me catch the cold of wisdom. And it helps me read men's hearts behind their faces. I'd give a quart of Peoria liquor to be able to watch you from my grave. I'd shove the clouds in Satan's eyes forever. If I could see you 20 years from now, I'd go and get your mother out of her grave in Glenwood. And I'd say to her, look, Biddy, look. That's our boy. Him that is of your blood and mind and the great heart of you. And Biddy would weep for joy while wind blew through the fire of her hair and the grand proud form of her stood straight up. See, Biddy Lawler, I'd say, for him did we dream not in vain. He's our boy with the hurt hearts of us underneath his own. He's a little mad, being a lawler. Then I'd say very quiet like, but you can't have everything, Biddy. I'm taking you for a walk, Biddy, to watch your son that's the son of my son. Don't you see, Biddy? He learned his politics from his granddad and how to carry his liquor. And from you, Biddy, he got everything that's in April. The quick tear and the pity for fool that need not be. And then when you'd gone, I'd go gallivanting over the blue meadows with Biddy, and out of their graves would come the mothers of men. And them that died with the birth of their children would be first. And all of them would sing softer than the feathers of robins in May, while Biddy and I played marbles with the stars. He laid his shovel-twisted hand upon my shoulder. I'm an old man with a dream that broke in his head. They think I don't think because I'm an old man with fire in his throat, but when I'm sausage for the worms, me boy, I want you to remember that old Huey Tully was not a fool. The old man walked slowly and ponderously. The heavy nails in his shoes scratched the cement pavement. We passed under an arc light. My grandfather's face was a hard mask with soft eyes. The light faded behind us. Even the moon was hidden. That, ladies and gentlemen, is Jim Tully.